His plan had moved forward to put me away. I took it so far with anyone there that I'd soon be lost. This is the part I like right here.
Consider the lilies, they don't toil nor spin, and there's not a king with more splendor than them. Consider the sparrows, they don't plant or sow, but they're fed by the Master who wants.
Good evening. Welcome tonight. Appreciate you taking time to join in with us tonight. Hope you're staying cool. It's nice and toasty out there. Some people like this extra warm weather. I like this better than the cold, so I'll take it. I'd rather sweat than put on a lot of clothes. But thank you for joining us tonight. We're going to open in prayer. If you have a need, we're going to take those before the Lord tonight as we open. Father, we thank you, God, for allowing us to come together over the airways tonight. We thank you, God, for being a God that loves and takes care of His children. And we know tonight, God, that you're concerned about every need that we have. And Father, we come tonight bringing our cares and our needs and our wants before you tonight, asking God for your help. God, because we understand, God, some things, God, that we may not understand, God, how they're going to work out, but we know you have a plan and a purpose, and God, you can work all things out. And Father, we come and we ask for your help, your direction, your guidance, and most of all, God, your healing hand, God, to intervene for those that need a healing, God, those that need a job tonight, provide that job, those that need a financial intervention tonight, God, make a way for them where there seems to be no way. God, we know there's not a problem or a circumstance that you cannot solve. And God, we ask all this tonight in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you again for joining us. Just a reminder, Sunday morning we will continue to begin at 10:30, and the kids will be able to meet in the back again. Just make sure you please just bring them no earlier than 10:15. Thank you for those that brought their children last week and obeying that. We appreciate it. That way they're not back there too long, and then the longer they're back there, the more tempted they are to break that social distance thing. But anyway, thank you for joining us tonight. Brother Roy is going to come and bring forth the word tonight. So I appreciate him and his ministry and appreciate him being willing to teach tonight. So he's going to share with you.
It's good to be here. We're going to try to do a little bit of teaching here. I'm going to go off of Mark, 4th chapter, and it's going to be through 35 through 41. If you want to follow along, I'm going to read it all kind of first, but then I'm going to go back over different parts of the verses and a few points and stuff there. So Mark 4, 35 through 41. Give you just a second out there just to get it, those that are listening. Say we really appreciate all that are watching now or later on. Sometimes you might be working and you have to watch later. But we appreciate that and hope that you get something out of this. And it's pretty good, I hope, pretty good for everybody. Mark 4, 35 through 41. And the same day, when the evening has come, he saith unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there were also with him other little ships. See, what was that on? That was, go a little further on that one. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat unto the ship, so that it was now full. Go ahead and go to 40 on that, we'll go all the way to 40. And there arose a great storm in the wind, and the waves beat on the ship, so that it was full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep in a pillow, and they awoke him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. We can stop right there. I'll go a little further, maybe a little bit later. But that's the key of the verses I'm wanting to talk about. And the title of my message is Be Still. Be Still. Sometimes that's just hard to do when circumstances can be around you so hard and seem to go in out of every direction. It's just to be still. To tell a little story here, when Sherman Fleming was a teenager, Sharon Fleming, was a teenager. Her family took cross-country car trips each summer. And to keep the peace, they each took a turn choosing a cassette. You can tell how old this story is. To play in the car tape deck. No one could complain or comment about another's choice. They weren't allowed to say, you know, we don't like this or like that. Each and every one of them got a chance to play their tape. Now, Sharon says her mother liked to listen to hymns. She chose contemporary Christian. Her younger brother preferred rock. And Dad, he always thought the best thing was a 90-minute tape that was still blank. See, that dad was looking for a little bit of peace. But aren't we all? We all sometimes are looking for a little bit of peace. In this uncertain times, don't we long for the assurance that all will be well? In a time where there's so much hate in the world, where there's so much destruction going on, so much you just don't know what's going on, you don't know going to the store what's going to happen, and in a time that is so uncertain, we yearn for the stillness of soul, even when the world around us is in turmoil. We want that assurance that everything's going to be all right. Well, if you have your Bibles, I invite you, you know, to go with me along with that, Mark 4. We're going to go through the different parts of that, 35 and on, and kind of talk about each scripture just a little bit there. But as we're starting out, where Jesus shows his disciples, you know, how to find true peace in the midst of a storm. I mean, we're talking about in the middle of everything crashing around. This whole story is about finding peace in the times of trouble. When it seems like everything's falling apart, you can still be still. As he said, be still. Now that the day was a day of teaching for Jesus, he had been teaching his disciples about the power of his word. And now it is time for the test. It was time for them that all that he's been talking to them about, all that he's been trying to teach them, now it was time to see what they have learned. Now it was time to see if they even, you know, learned anything. In Mark 36, we see, at 4:36, we see leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. He was sitting there. I mean, he was just got done. He was teaching out of the boat. And he tells them, you know, hey, we, you know, to move on to the other side. You know, and the disciples obey their Lord immediately. I mean, Jesus said it. Okay, we're going to do it. And that's a good start with everything, is for us to do what he tells us to do. And Jesus had been teaching from the boat. So they waste no time in leaving for the other side, just as Jesus told them to do. Now, what we see in 37, a major storm came up. And the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly, you know, sinking. I mean, it says that it was coming into the boat. One version says it was swapping into the boat. It was filling the boat. So the waves were coming in. And, you know, if you're out in the middle of the water and, you know, you don't really see each side of the land and it's a long ways off and everything's dark and the storm's coming and it looks like you're about ready to sink, sometimes to be still, we're looking at each other, be still, I'm sinking. And we don't see, we just see panic. But literally the waves kept spilling over into the boat so that it was nearly sinking. I mean, it was to the point where things were starting to go. Even though the disciples did exactly what Jesus told them to do, they ran right into trouble, right into a storm, which threatened to sink their little boat. I mean, they were doing what Jesus told them to do, right? But yet there it was. There was still trouble. There was still a storm coming. There was still, their boat was getting ready to sink. And you see, many people have the ideal that storms come to their lives only when they disobey God, only maybe when they're in sin, or only when things, you know, but you know, sometimes that is it. Sometimes our actions and our consequences of things that we have done, sometimes that is when things go wrong. But not all the time. Not every time. You see, often they come because of our obedience as the forces of evil opposes us trying to accomplish God's will. Do you think that the devil wants us to do what God wants? No. You see, the devil's all about trying to test our faith. He's all about trying to discourage us, and we're doing what God's telling us to do. God, I'm paying my tithes. I go to church. I'm seeking you. I'm trying to do everything that you want me to do. But yet, storm still comes. Things still happen. You still have moments where you don't know if you're going to be able to pay your house payment. You got times when you don't know, you know, if you're going to be laid off and maybe even laid off. Maybe, you know, health issues come your way. You see, the enemy will test us and try to make us lose faith. Is this the God that you want to serve? Is there really a God? Surely you must be doing something wrong because bad things are happening. He wants us to doubt God. You see, Jesus never promised us the absence of a storm in our lives. He never said, once you get saved, once you give your heart to Him, He's going to put you in this little bubble and everything's going to be perfect and it's going to be roses and we're going to skip and be happy every day. He never said that. He promised only that He would be with us through the storms, which He allows only to test and strengthen our faith with Him. He said He would be with us. He didn't say you wouldn't have problems, but He said, I will be with you in those problems. I will help you through those problems. I will help strengthen you through these problems. You see, in Mark 4:38, Jesus was in the stern sleeping, it says, on a pillow or on a cushion or on whatever version. You see, the disciples woke Him up and said to Him, Teacher, don't you care that we drowned? They're freaking out. They're panicking. I mean, everything seems to be falling apart. They were focusing on the problem. And the problem is the boat's getting ready to sink. And how many times in life have we been in that situation where it seems like our boat is starting to sink? And we start panicking. And we start saying, God, where are you? Don't you care about me? Teacher, don't you care if we drowned? They said. I love the picture this picture presents here. It says Jesus is at peace. It says He was so at peace, He was there sleeping. The storms are going on around Him. The boat's getting ready to sink. And Jesus was calm and just sitting there. He was asleep in the middle of this terrible storm. But the disciples are so clueless, they mistake His calmness for a lack of concern. And so many times in life we do the same thing. We think, God, where are you? This is, you know, we need something to happen this very minute. And we get to this point that we think, okay, God must not care because He's being still at the moment. Because we don't have the answer we need this very moment. And we confuse it for the lack of concern. Sometimes in the middle of our storms, we are like that God is calm. We hear nothing but storm and think, God, where are you? Where are you? Everything's collapsing around me. I don't know how this is going to work. I don't know how this is going to take care of things. You know, I got issues going on with the house, or I got things going on at home, or I got things going on with my kids or my spouse or my family. My health issues. When all the time He is right next to us in the storm. Right there, already making a way, already working things out. But we are too focused on the storm to see Him. We're too focused on the issues going around us. And we lose sight that Jesus is standing right beside us. He's standing right there with us through all this, getting us through it. But we don't see it at the time because we're panicking. It's kind of like, you know, when we have anxiety and anxiety attacks. I know how that is. And sometimes you get to the point where you're breathing and everything around you, you don't know really is happening. And really, it's not as bad as you think it is because you're just so busy focusing on the problem. In 39, He says, He got up, rebuked the wind, and He said to the waves, quiet, be still, be still. He rebuked them, be still, or peace, be still. In the middle of the storm, He's saying, peace, be still. Then the wind died down and it was completely calm. Just totally. Jesus said the same thing He said to the demons earlier in Mark 1:25 and Luke 4:35 in both of those verses. Literally, He said, be silent or be muzzled. And that's exactly what happened. The wind stopped howling and the water was completely calm. We went from the waves so high going over the boat, the sky, the storms, everything else to just everything calm. Just with a word of peace be still. And 40, verse 40, He said to His disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? Why are you fearful? Why are you scared? Do you not believe I'm sitting right here next to you? After Jesus rebuked the wind, he rebuked his disciples for the lack of faith. You see, they had failed the test. The test of everything he's been trying to tell them. That he was always there. That his word is how powerful his word is. That he would never leave us. He'd never forsake us, no matter how bad things are. Even after all the miracles Jesus had done, the lame could walk, the deaf could hear, the blind could see, all the miracles that they seen him do. Even after all that Jesus had taught them, they still didn't totally trust. And that's why they were afraid. You see, in Mark 4:41, they were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this, even that the wind and the waves obey him?" I mean, who is this that he just says one word and everything goes calm? Waves going up high and now all of a sudden they're just calm. The wind is calm. Everything is just still. You see, they were afraid of Jesus as well as they witnessed his awesome power. You see, the greatest danger to his disciples was not the wind or the waves. You see, the greatest danger was the unbelief in their own hearts. The unbelief that no matter what happens, he is in control. You see, I think Christians are like that sometimes after all that he has done for us. And we ask God to take care of this need. And then we don't trust that he will do it. We unbelief. God, I need this miracle. I need this miracle in my body. I need this miracle in my family or my friend's body. I need this miracle financially. I need this miracle. And we pray for this. But then after we're praying for it, there's something inside of us that still says, maybe this isn't going to happen. Maybe because we think it's too big. Maybe because we have asked before and didn't get the results we thought we should have got. Or maybe we're still waiting on this. Because you see, the human nature is very impatient. And the human nature says, we're asking for this and we need it right now. Even though we don't realize God knows when we really need it. Or if we need it. You see, Warren Wiersbe put it this way. Our greatest problems are within us, not around us. And then in this world, that's exactly how that is. Our greatest problems are within us, each and every one of us. It's not so much around us, it's in us. So no matter what is going on around you, make sure you have faith within. You have faith here. Make sure you are trusting in Christ. Make sure you are depending on Him, not us. We've seen what happens when we depend on ourselves. The Bible is full of it. I mean, look at Abraham. Because he depended on himself, when God said, hey, I'm going to give you a child, and he thought, okay, we're going to do it ourselves. Now we see what happens. I mean, actually, that's consequences that today still affects the world, affected everything, because he didn't trust God to do what he said. But make sure you are resting in him, for then and only then will you be able to rest in the storm. First of all, trust in the word. Depend on the Lord has told you to do. Trust him, you know, depend on it. If the Lord has told you to do it, count on his commands. He's not going to lead you to somewhere just to set you up to fail. In verse 35, Jesus told his disciples, let us go over to the other side. He made his will clear, and nothing can stop him from working out his will. Nothing's going to stop that out. If he told them, hey, let's go to the other side, we're going to go to the other side, it's going to go to the other side. He's going to make sure they go to the other side. God said in Isaiah 55, as the rain and the snows come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You see, His word is guaranteed. His word you can bank on. He just says that right there. Whatever I say is going to happen. God's will, as expressed in His word, is unstoppable. It's unstoppable. His word cannot change. His word cannot be interrupted. His word cannot be voided. It's guaranteed. He will do what He said He would do, and He will give us the power to do what He's asked us to do as well. He will accomplish His plan. What He commands, He empowers. His precepts are promises of what we can accomplish as we depend on Christ. He told His disciples to go to the other side, so as they go, He will make sure they get there. He will always take care. He will always do what He says He's going to do. His word constantly says, I am always with you. I will always take care of you. I will always be with you no matter what. He just got finished teaching him that His word is powerful, that it produces tremendous results. His word was the deaf, hear, the lame, stand and walk, the blind. It didn't matter what it was. If He said for it to happen, it happened. You see, now they have an opportunity to see it happen right before their very eyes. All they need to do is trust in the Word, and they'll have nothing to fear. If we trust in His Word, there's nothing to fear. Not the storms of the Sea of Galilee, not even the legion of demons that they meet on the other side. You see, there was a man, and an immigrant, and he was recalls immigrating from Germany to America. You see, in December of 1958, he traveled on the USS Butner, a support ship, out of Birmingham, through the North Sea and into the North Atlantic. Huge waves pounded the ship, and every day seemed the same. Water, 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 every which way he looked. Water, everywhere, to the north, to the south, to the east, to the west. Heckel says it was everywhere. All we could hear was the grinding of the ship's engine. But then he says, finally, 5 days later, the scene changed dramatically. There was water to the east and to the south, but to the west stood the Statue of Liberty gleaming in the morning sun. We had come home, Heckles recalls. Well, that's what it's like to follow Jesus sometimes. Waves of oppositions pounding against us with no change in sight in all directions. It seems like everything is falling apart. There seems to be nothing but trouble. And the Lord seems to be asleep. Then the day comes when we realize that we've been moving according to His plan all along. We see nothing but hard times. We see nothing but struggle to our right, to our left, in every which way. But then all of a sudden, we see, oh, wait a minute. God had control the whole time. So don't be afraid. Instead, depend on God's Word. Just do what He tells you to do. Trust Him and get where He wants you to go. Rest in the Lord and so find rest in the storm. First of all, trust in His Word. We must always trust in His Word. Then second, trust in His presence. Depend on His being right there with you. Count on His company. Just because we don't see Him doesn't mean He isn't right there. And to be honest with you, I remember times in some of my darkest hours, some of my hardest times, some times when, you know, I felt like I wasn't going to make it anymore. Like, it just felt like I was getting ready to have a nervous breakdown, or it felt like everything was falling apart and there's nothing more I could do. And there was times I felt like, where are you? I don't feel you. But He's still there. He is still there. Jesus was right there in the boat with His disciples. They had nothing to worry about, and neither do we. Jesus has promised us, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. In Hebrews 13:5, in Psalms 46 says, God is an ever-present help in trouble. Trust in His Word, and trust that He's always there. You see, when the Titanic was launched, 16 skilled mechanics, all from the city of Belfast, were on her maiden voyage. The city was very proud of these men who had part in building what they called the unsinkable ship. See, the news came that the Titanic had sunk in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean and that all 16 had gone down with her. The city was overcome with grief. Grown men would meet each other in the street, burst into tears, and then walk away without saying a word. An American preacher was in Belfast that week, and he was scheduled to speak at the church that Sunday. All 16 mechanics were members at that church, and it was packed with the newly made widows, orphan children, and people who all over the city came. And the preacher titled his message, "The Unsinkable Ship." But he wasn't talking about the Titanic. See, he was talking about a frail little boat on the Sea of Galilee, unsinkable because Jesus was there asleep on the pillow. You see, when you're with Jesus, you're safe. The storm may be great and your little boat very frail, but if Jesus is there, your ship is unsinkable. He will not let you drown in the sea of adversity. Instead, He will bring you safely through the storms to the place He wants you to be. So don't be afraid. Just trust in His presence. See, that's what Urba Wada did when he was in southern part in Ethiopia during the time of communists in the 74 to 91. He was walking with Christian youth at the time. Working with Christian youth at the time. And he describes what happened when the party leaders read his report about his work. He said, the authorities decided I had to be executed because of my treasonous words. The commandant told him, the only way you can overturn this sentence is for you to not deny you are one of the believers. Walter told the commandant, if they execute me, I'll be immediately with the Lord. So the commandant put him in prison to await his execution. But there Walter says, my Savior gave me songs to sing I had never heard before. God turned him into a composer, so he and his fellow prisoners revelled in the joys of praise, as Walter put it. The guards kept trying to silence them, but with the threat of execution hanging over them, they said, why should we keep quiet? 7 men had come to Christ in that prison, and they all sang together. One particular guard, though, took delight in mocking them, telling them and insulting them and hollering at them. He would put filthy words to the tunes they sang. And one night he patted his revolver and promised, tomorrow morning, at this time, you won't be in the land of the living. Just after midnight that evening, a tremendous storm burst on the town and the prison. Huge hailstones fell, wrecking several roofs, including the one where the insulting guard was sleeping. He was terrified. He pulled out his revolver and shot at random into the dark, using up all of his bullets that he has promised would finish the Christians off the next day. You see, one by one, the roofs were taken off the commandant's house. The judge the administrator, and his deputy. The prisoners in cells 3, 4, and 5 got soaked from the rain, but they were in cell 1 and were kept dry. But there were a lot of wet and unhappy people that night. But you see, at 9 o'clock the next morning, Wada and his Christian friends expected the cruel guard to fulfill his promise to shoot them. But instead, they saw a remarkable sight. The commandant was pushing that same guard into their cell without his uniform and whipping him with his belt. You see, other people in the background were yelling, We told this man to leave the believers alone. But he refused. And so God has sent this terrible punishment on the town and prison. After some time, the guard was released and given back his uniform. Then he told the believers, "I know that the Lord was with you. I know the way I should have treated you, but Satan persuaded me otherwise. Please forgive me." Wada says, "We did, and several more men came to Christ in that prison." You see, when Christ is with us, we can guarantee that His will be done. There's nothing, nobody, no circumstances out there that can change His will. When He is with you, His will be done. His kingdom will be expanded, and we have nothing to fear, not even death itself. See, just rest in the Lord, and you will find rest in the storm. See, first trust in His Word, second trust in His presence, and then finally trust in His power. Depend on His might, count on His authority and control. You see, the Gospel of Mark makes it very clear that Jesus has all authority. He has authority over the forces of evil. He has authority over sickness. He has authority over to forgive sins. He has authority over the Sabbath. And He has authority here. We see that He has authority over the wind and the waves. So over nature. Jesus is Lord. He is in charge. So much that all of creation must answer to Him. We're talking about somebody that spoke the world into existence. The stars, the sky. Therefore, we do not need to be afraid. Mark Galley, in his book, Jesus Mean and Wild, tells about the time a group of refugees started attending the church he pastored in Sacramento. After the service one Sunday, they approached him and asked to become members. They had only been there, you know, their rough understanding of the Christian faith. So Pastor Mark suggested they study the Gospel of Mark together for a few weeks to make sure they knew what a commitment to Christ and His church entitled. They happily agreed. See, Mark says those Bible studies were some of the most interesting he has ever led. After they read the passage in which Jesus calms the storm, Mark began, as he usually did, with more theologically sophisticated groups. He asked them about the storms in their lives. There was a puzzled look among the refugee friends. See, a liberator, you know, he kind of said, "Well, we all have storms. We all have problems, we have worries, we have troubles and crisis. And this story teaches that Jesus can give us peace in the midst of those storms." "So what are your storms?" he asked. Again, more puzzled, silence. Finally, one of the men hesitantly asked, "Do you mean that Jesus actually calmed the wind and sea in the middle of the storm?" You see, Mark thought that the man was finding the story doubtful, and Mark didn't want to get distracted with the problem of the miracles. So he replied, "Yes, but we should not get hung up on the details of the miracle. We should remember that Jesus can calm the storms in our lives." There was another stretch of awkward silence until another replied, "Well, if Jesus calmed the wind and the waves, he must be a powerful man." At this, they all nodded vigorously and chattered excitedly to one another. Mark says, "Except for me, the room was full of wonder. I suddenly realized that they grasped the story better than I did." With all our sophistication, let's not miss the wonder here. Jesus is very powerful. Therefore, we don't need to be afraid. Just rest in the Lord and you will find rest in the storm. First of all, trust in His Word. Second, trust in His presence. And third, trust in His power. See, in the issue of today's Christian magazine, Julie talks about the time she discovered her daughter Allison was smoking pot. You see, Julie noticed her daughter's weight loss, her pinpoint pupils, and her who-gives-a-rip attitude. Upon inspecting her daughter's purse, she found a leopard-colored pipe and the unmistakable sweet odor of pot. You see, when Julie tried to talk to her daughter, Allison jerked away, stormed out of the room, and within minutes was back to college. Julie says, "I knew what I had to do. I knew what I had to do. Abandon everything in my life and start to worry. Fix, control, full time." How many times is this in our lives? Worry, control, fix. Everything in my life. Julie began spending most of her days by the phone. She evaluated Allison's reactions, gestures, and comments. Thoughts circled her mind like buzzards. What if she never stops? What if I never see her again? What if she overdoses? What if she goes to jail? How many times does that happen in our lives? We worry so much, we're so far out of control, and things circle our mind, the worst case scenario. We see Julie lured Allison into a therapy by promising they'd go to an Italian restaurant before visit. But even that didn't work. After just a few visits, Allison refused to see the counselor, dropped out of college, stopped answering her mother's call. Julie was convinced that if she forgot about Allison, even for a second, or enjoyed anything, something bad might happen. Several months later, after another night of little sleep, Julie glanced in the mirror. She says, "I could have passed for an addict. Dark circles under hopeless eyes." So she called her friend Linda. Linda's son, also an addict, had been sentenced to state prison. "You can't imagine all that's going on here," Julie told her. "Come over for coffee," Linda urged. And when they got together, Linda just listened and then said simply, "You need help." Julie argued, "You haven't heard the whole story. I'm fine. My daughter, she's the one that needs help." To which Linda replied, "You're addicted to worry and control." "I've been where you are." Then Linda told her story. "It took me years to realize that I'm not in charge. God is." Linda admitted, "By worrying, you're telling God He can't handle things. When we worry and we get so stressed out, we're saying, 'God, I don't know if you can handle this.'" And that's what she said right here. You see, then she invited Julie to go to a meeting with her. There, Julie met others just like herself and learned that worry was just as dangerous and addictive as alcohol and drugs. You see, Julie didn't think change was possible, but she knew one thing for sure. She was destroying her life with things that she could not control, with things that she could not handle. That night at home, Julie got real with God. "Help me, God," she prayed. "I can't do this without you." Then she began to ask God for help each morning. She whispered to herself, "Not my job," as worry, fear, and control tried to needle its way back in. 2 years after the first meeting, Julie's daughter, Allison, and her met for lunch. See, Allison had gone back to the same therapist on her own. "You can't imagine how easy it is to study when you're not high," Allison laughed. "Nope, I guess not," Julie said as she blinked back happy tears. "Thanks, Mom." "For what?" "When you didn't fix my problems, it scared me," Allison said. "A few times I had to dig change out of my seat of my car for gas money. Some days," as she paused, "I didn't even have food." Then Allison continued, "I'm making A's. And look," she handed her mom her checkbook, "I have money now." Julie concludes, "Recovery defies logic. It means nothing to do opposite of what feels natural." In closing, so many times we don't realize that we can get addicted to worry. We can get addicted to control when things are not going the way we think we should, or things aren't going the way or as fast as we think in the right direction. And then we get worried. And at that time, God is telling us, in that storm of our lives, "Be still. Be still, because my word is guaranteed. My presence is right here next to you." Remember, no matter what the enemy throws at you, no matter what storms you are going through, God will always be with you. Just remember and tell yourself, "Be still and listen. He will take care of you." I hope you got something out of this message. I hope it touched you. I hope it gave you something encouraging. And I hope you have a good week.
As the blackness of night closed on the light, my heart sank with fear. My desperate cry rang out with pride. All I could see was no hope.